We'd like to call one of our members of chamber, Daniel Lustig. Will you please introduce our next speaker?
Sure, thank you. Good evening, I'm Daniel Lustig, and I'm actually the attorney for the Puerto Rican County Chamber of Commerce. And it is my pleasure to introduce to you Professor Eitan Gilboa. Oh, you want to introduce it? Yeah, sure. Go ahead, please.
My name is Sharon Evans, and I'm the co-founder and vice chair of the Isabel Public Diplomacy Forum. It is a real great pleasure for us to be here tonight, and I would like to give a special thanks to all our partners. We have many of them, as you can see. I wish I could say it right before. Talk to a week, and I was trying to see if I could say the way he said it, but I'm all the R's. Oh, I was practicing, I didn't get it right. Okay, the Chamber of Commerce, the Jewish Federation of Palm Beach, who has been very, very helpful, Palm Beach State College, what a beautiful campus, and of course, Daniel from Titan, who we met when we first were here and arranged to put this all together. So thank you all of us for partnering in the event tonight. We too are sorry that there were more people, because it's really going to be a dynamic talk. IPD Forum was founded in 2014 by Professor Eitan Gilboa and myself. And we had a vision, and our vision was to create an educational organization that would bring delegations of experts, like tonight, from Israel, to share an unbiased view about current issues that are not always presented in the media. We hope that these discussions will help bridge these gaps and encourage open and frank discussions regarding the many challenges the world is facing today, not just on a policy level, but more importantly between people. Since our inception 3 years ago, we have conducted 2 to 3 programs a year in both the United States and Europe. Most recently, we were in Texas, Ohio. Can you not hear me? Can't hear me? Okay, we're recording. Okay, and now? Trick. It's fine. Okay, so just recently we were in Texas and Ohio, Slovakia and the Czech Republic. Next month we have a delegation that is going to Hungary and Slovenia. And we're hopefully in Australia in 2018. We collaborate with local organizations, as you saw tonight, to enable us to create partnerships within the community. We are strictly academic and privately funded, and not affiliated with any government entities. This distinction allows us to share nonpartisan information with our audiences. If you have a look on your chairs, you'll see our Florida program. Has anybody not got a program? If you all open your programs, you'll see that we came from Orlando where we had a variety of events. We're here for 5 days in Palm Beach. So if you like what you hear tonight, you're welcome to come and join us at our other events. And then we're off to Tampa. The evening's lecture today presents us with a unique and imperative opportunity to discuss what is on our minds, cybersecurity. So I want to thank you really all for coming out tonight. I know the rain, and I know there was traffic because we got caught in it. But I think you will find it all worthwhile, and you'll find that the discussion will be provoking and informative at the same time. Okay, I'd like to call upon Daniel now to introduce Professor Gilboa. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. So, Professor Eitan Gilboa has served in many prominent academic positions in Israel and the U.S. He has been a professor of international communication as well as the founder and first director of both the School of Communication and the Center for International Communication at Bar Ilan University in Israel. He is a senior research associate at BESA Center for Strategic Studies, chair of the Israeli Communication Association, founding chair and academic director of the Israel Public Diplomacy Forum. He is a world-renowned expert on international communication, diplomacy, and public diplomacy, and U.S. policy in the Middle East. Prof. Professor Gilboa graduated summa cum laude from the Hebrew University and received his MA, Master's of Arts, PhD, right, in government from Harvard University. He taught at the Hebrew University and has been a visiting professor at several leading American and European universities, including Harvard, UCLA, Georgetown, American University in Washington, D.C., Tufts, USC, and the University of Pembroke. It is with great pleasure that we welcome you here to Palm Beach County. Thank you for making the trip, and we are very excited and interested to hear what you have to say. Thank you. It's going to be great.
Good evening. Thank you very much for this kind introduction, Dalia. The issue that I want to discuss this evening is security at different levels, national as well as individual, system versus, again, the individual. And I'm taking Israel as a case study. The kind of issues and problems that Israel faces and has to cope with exist also in other places at different, perhaps, scope. Even in the United States, some of these issues exist. So this is going to be an exercise in national and cybersecurity, as the title suggests. So I'd like to begin with concepts that will help us to put the matter in perspective. First is peace. The best security is to have peace, both at home and abroad. And there are two kinds of peace, at least in international context. One is cold peace, which means the absence of war, the absence of violence, the absence of terrorism. And the second one is warm peace, which goes beyond that into international relations. It means that you have people-to-people peace. Often, governments sign peace agreements, but that's all. The public is not part of it, the public is not engaged. In war and peace, the public is also involved and also engaged. So two kinds of peace. Cold peace is better than warm war. But warm peace is the best. Now, in terms of security, we need to distinguish between two kinds of security. One is basic security, strategic, from a strategic perspective. The other one is called routine security. It's mostly tactical. If you want, for example, terrorism is what we call routine security. So now we can move further to see what is happening in the Middle East and Israel, and we can play a little bit with these concepts. So this is the Middle East, and okay. So Israel is there. You see Israel, very small, and we have a number of immediate neighbors. Egypt is here. We have a peace agreement with Egypt since 1978-79. Many people think that there is no such thing as peace in the Middle East. There has been. And we have here Jordan. We have also a peace agreement with Jordan since 1994. Next, here is the Palestinian Authority. Here we had a beginning of a peace process. It's called the Oslo peace process. It has not moved forward as expected, and there are still many disagreements here. Most of the problems are with these neighbors. These are not nice neighbors. One is Lebanon, and the other one is Syria. So these are the immediate neighbors, and I'm arguing that peace for Israel means first and foremost peace with these immediate neighbors. We have also a huge problem with this country. Why there is a conflict between Iran and Israel, it's hard to understand. Iran is here, far, we don't have any border with Iran. We never had a territorial argument or conflict with Iran. But Iran now is the leading foe of Israel. And here we have other countries with whom we have all kinds of relations. This is Turkey here. We've had better relations with Turkey in recent years. Due to Islamization of Turkey, things have become a little bit complicated. But this is Israel. And this is the West Bank. It's controlled by the Palestinian Authority. And this is Gaza, controlled by Hamas. Recently, they reached an agreement. We'll see what will happen with that. So again, this is Syria. These are the Golan Heights that were captured from Syria back in 1967, 50 years ago. And this is Lebanon. This is information about Israel, which I don't have time to show you. So this is Iran, and I've mentioned before Iran. This is basic security. So this is the missile arsenal that Iran is developing. And it became controversial last week when President Trump announced that he would not confirm Iranian compliance with the nuclear deal. He did not abolish it either, so it's in between somewhere. This is a huge arsenal of missiles that Iran has developed. And this is a statement that was made not far ago by the foreign minister of Iran. Iran will not use ballistic missiles to attack any country. But this is September 1916, a few months before that, an Iranian officer say that the missiles had been designed to reach Israel. This is an experiment with a missile. It says here in Hebrew and Persian, in Hebrew, Iran should be wiped out of the map. That much you can believe Iranian officials. So Iran is a big problem for Israel. And Iran established, if we look back now to the map here, Iran established two proxies. There's a proxy here called Hezbollah, a Shiite group, which is receiving money, training, and missiles and equipment from Iran. And here is Hamas. So Iran built two proxies here to help its campaign against Israel. So I'm going to talk a little bit about it. So Hezbollah, 20,000 fighters, 20,000 reservists, 120,000 missiles. Very few countries in the world have 120 missiles. So the missiles covered much of Israel. What is less known is, since we talk about a hostile neighborhood, that in the last few years, since the outbreak of the Syrian civil war, Israel treated thousands of wounded Syrians who came to the border between Israel and Syria, severely wounded, and were treated in Israeli hospitals. They came very, very anti, and went out much more pro. So this is like good neighborhood approach. This is Gaza, not a good place, very crowded. They also have missiles. And this represents a security threat to Israel. They have all kinds of missiles, and these missiles have this range. So all of Israel, basically, three cities, Haifa, Tel Aviv, and Jerusalem, you see this? Two-thirds of Israel lives in that triangle. So all of it is covered by those missiles. And there were three military operations conducted against Israel from Gaza in the last 2 years. The last one was just about 2 years ago. These are rockets that they launched from inside civilian territory into Israeli cities. These are tunnels. So they send rockets and they dig tunnels. These are the tunnels. This is the former Secretary General of the United Nations. And this is a tunnel that we discovered. And the purpose of the tunnels, these are the purposes of the tunnel. What they do, they dig tunnels. See, this is the border between Gaza and Israel. They dig tunnels, they get out, and they kill people. That's the idea. So you do it from through rockets and also through these tunnels. This is a security threat at the national level. How we want to block it? This is the solution. You know, this is Gaza. We have not the choice but to do this. It's like an underground, a concrete barrier, dozens of meters, and above ground as well. So the idea is to defend yourself by building that barrier. It has already started about a year ago and moving forward. Now I want to talk for a few minutes, and this will bring us into the cybersecurity area. This is called the Lone Wolf Terrorist. This is a terrorist that wakes up in the morning, or maybe a few days before, and decides to kill someone. To kill mostly civilians, could be even women and children. There were all kinds of attacks like that in recent years. So the question is this. Could you stop a terror attack by reporting a Facebook status? Could individual Facebook statuses indicate a person's plan to carry out a terror attack? Could policing social media help prevent terrorist attacks? The answer is yes, but. And I want to spend a few minutes about that. This brings us into the individual level security, from national security to individual level security and to cyber security. So what are the characteristics of the lone wolf terrorist? Here are these characteristics. Prepare and commits violent acts alone, obviously by definition, alone. Commits political oriented violence. It's not a crime, a regular crime, it's a political crime. Third, ideological and personal motivation. So ideological, but it could be personal motivation. There was the last incident of a few weeks ago. The person was highly depressed. His wife left him. He felt very alone. And he decided there's no reason to leave. So why not to conduct a hero terrorist act and be famous. So a lot of mental disturbances and problems like that. Hero publicity and status. So if you commit an act of terror by yourself, you become a hero, you achieve a status that otherwise you would not have. Outside of any command structure, this is why it's very difficult to find a person like that before. Because if you belong to a terrorist organization, intelligence services are likely to follow you, and perhaps on many, many times, you could be stopped without material assistance from any group. Primitive weapons, you don't need much. You can use a wife, a knife. Freudian, yeah? Freudian. You know, the thing is that sometimes people send their wives to do it. They want to get rid of them. So, Caesars, or even cars. Cars. Simply have a car and you use it as a weapon. This is like the knife, it's called the knife Intifada. This is the use of knife as a weapon. These are the vehicular ramming attack. And it started in Jerusalem and it moved to Europe. So several incidents of that kind happened in the UK, Belgium, France, in Sweden, other places. Again, knives and cars. So this, now we come to Facebook. And very interesting that many of those who committed acts of terror at the individual level have published blogs declaring their intention to pursue an act of terror. For example, this guy, he Omar El Abed, before he killed three Israeli citizens in Jerusalem on July 2017. This is the text in Arabic. And this is the translation of that text. It says here, all that I have is a sharpened knife, and it is answering the call of Al-Aqsa. Shame on you, etc., etc. He indicates here that he is going to conduct an act of terror. If we could have captured that ahead of time, perhaps that person would have been stopped. Another example is this guy, Mahdi Akas, and I don't have time, so I'm giving you just a few examples. I come from international communication. My colleague comes from a different background. So we've investigated the use of social media by terror organizations. And I myself, I conducted a research about use of the social media by the Islamic State terror organization, for example. So I come to this issue, to the individual security from that perspective of international communication. This guy, this is November 2015, he stabbed an Israeli man. The day he carried out the attack, he changed his profile picture on Facebook to a masked man, see this, right here, with an accompanied text stating he was a martyr. Whenever someone declares that he is going to be a martyr, he is likely to commit an act of terror. That's another example. This guy is Muhammad Halabi. He killed two Israelis, seriously injured two others, including a two-year-old in Jerusalem, a week before, not a day before, a week before. He posted a Facebook status declaring an intifada and demanding a response to Palestinian humiliation. Response means, I'm going to do it. This is another example of another person. So you see, you get the idea. So here's the question. How can we identify these people and stop them before they are able to kill someone? This is a major challenge to intelligence services and security. So this is like finding a needle in a haystack. What you need, we have instruments for analyzing the threat. We have analytics which the social media themselves provide, that we can improve on them. Natural language, artificial intelligence, and sentiment analysis software. Have you heard about that? That's unbelievable, right?
Yes, it's fascinating how they do it.
Right. So there are all kinds of tools that could help us stop those would-be terrorists. So the challenge is, first of all, there's no problem with data. We have a lot of data. The problem is how to find these people. So scan and monitor keywords. If we use keywords, remember Montiel, keywords. Artificial intelligence, speed. Oh, speed is important, because if you, the examples I've shown you were discovered after the act, too late. So we need speed in order to prevent those acts of terror. We need a prevention action. We have to find that person. We have to stop it, or her. Social media dilemma Well, here's an interesting dilemma. On the one hand, we fight Facebook and Twitter for providing a stage for terrorists and terrorist organizations. On the other hand, if we prohibit that, we would not know there would be terrorists. So this is an interesting intelligence dilemma. I am still in favor of preventing the social media from publishing information, incitement to hate and to hatred and to violence. I'm against that. This is misuse of social media. And we need cooperation at all levels. We need cooperation, government, industry, and university. The approach should be interdisciplinary. Both social scientists like myself and technology people like my colleague, who is going to speak in a minute or so. And it should be, the cooperation should be also international. Because this would be the only way, really, to deal with those heavy national security threats. This is the end of my initial presentation. I moved from very national system level threats to individual threats and to cybersecurity. And my colleague, Ito Sivan Sibilia, will continue now with his focus on cybersecurity.